Welcome to KluCon Weekly. Join us every Wednesday to learn about the latest cutting-edge developments in the real-time communications industry. KluCon Weekly is brought to you by FreeSwitch Solutions. Get support and professional services directly from the creators of the FreeSwitch open source project, solving your issues in the most efficient, stable, and scalable way possible. Get the FreeSwitch advantage. Visit freeswitch.com. Also brought to you by KluCon, the premier technology conference for developers by developers. Join us every summer in Chicago. KluCon kicks off on Monday with our annual hackathon, The Coder Games, followed by 3 days of technology-rich presentations discussing telecom, WebRTC, and IoT from developers around the world. To learn more, visit klucon.com or call 877-74-A-CLUE.
All right, welcome to KluCon Weekly. Today is the 10th of January, 2018. And this week, we're going to have a special guest, Mr. Michael Collins. For you guys that don't know Michael, Michael was the community liaison. He helped run KluCon Weekly for forever and a day. And then his day job kind of took him elsewhere. But so he's going to be joining us today. We're going to find out what he's been up to lately. So you guys stand by for that. Miss Kathleen, how are you doing today?
I'm doing really well. Thanks, Ken. Your announcements today. Hello, first of all, and thank you for joining us today for KluCon Weekly with Michael Collins. If you have any questions during the call, please comment in the YouTube, HipChat, IRC, and we will try and answer them during the call. And don't miss next week because we have Randy Resnick with the new VUC. And we are super excited to announce that OpenSIPS will be back again as a KluCon 2018 sponsor and providing their OpenSIPS training. Don't miss this great learning opportunity. You can learn straight from the guys. It's the best way to get in there and get everything you need to know. And if you're interested in sponsoring KluCon, you can send us an email at marketing@klucon.com. And don't forget to save the date for KluCon. KluCon will be earlier this year, taking place from July 23rd to July 26th. You can register right now on klucon.com. And if you register now, take advantage of our early bird special. You can save $600 if you're staying at the hotel by registering with the code CC2018EARLYBIRD. And you only have until January 31st to take advantage of this awesome deal. So 3 more weeks, guys. Get out there, get registered. And speaker submissions open on February 1st, so start writing those slides today. It's coming up really quick. Again, 3 weeks. So get those written and get those submitted. It's going to be a really fantastic conference this year. Speaking of conferences, in February, the team is heading to Fort Lauderdale, Florida for IT Expo, and we're going to be at booth 120. So stop by, get some limited edition swag, play tic-tac-verto, win some cool prizes. And then we'll be offering a free full-day training the day before on February the 13th. The sign-up link is on our website, our social media, and in the video notes below. So go reserve your spot for that today. And if you have any suggestions for videos you would like to see here on KluCon Weekly or even demonstration videos, please email us at marketing@klucon.com. We'll continue to add instructional videos periodically, so make sure you subscribe and you'll get all the latest and greatest updates. And as usual, be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to this channel, and sign up for our mailing list to get these and even more fantastic news and announcements from the FreeSwitch team. And that's it for me, Ken.
Thank you, Ken. For today's Community Corner, we have a question from Ray Mundo. And the question is for a member of our FreeSwitch team, Fred. Ray Mundo asks, hello, I have a problem with an outbound call. I need to bridge the call only when silence isn't detected on the V-leg.
Thanks, Michael. My assumption would be that by silence, it means that there is no ALI media detected on the V-leg. ALI media is the media received before the session is set up or answered. And the best option would be to use monitor ALI media ring variable, which monitors predefined ringtone. A total counter can be set, and once the tone is detected those number of times during a call, then the call is connected, else the call will be dropped. This variable only works, of course, when ignore early media variable is not present. That's the best way I think I can answer that question, Michael. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Fred.
You're welcome.
And so today we have Michael Collins, who is the former community leader for the Free Switch Project. So, Michael, what have you been up to?
Just a little bit of context. I've known the Free Switch guys since 2007, thereabouts. Worked with them at Barracuda Networks for a number of years, building the CudaTel. And the CudaTel was end of life back in 2016. So I went from doing VoIP and telecom over there at Barracuda to going to a completely different thing for me. First time in 20 plus years that I've not been in the PBX or telecom industry. And I'm actually doing cloud security. So if you've ever heard of Amazon Web Services or AWS and Microsoft, they have Azure, and now Google has entered the fray with the GCP. So what I'm currently doing is I'm helping people move their workloads into the cloud. So what's happening is people are saying, well, why should I have a server on-prem or have a server in Rackspace? I'll just, you know, rent some CPU from AWS or Google or Microsoft, and I'll just let them, you know, handle that. I'll just put my code out there. And so what we do is we help people take those workloads from the prem or from their data center and get them out to the cloud. And so security is like the big thing that people are dealing with. Like, I want to throw a website out there, right? I want to throw a website out there, and I want to protect it from SQL injections and from crazy attacks like that. You know, you've all heard of Equifax. Remember, Equifax had that big breach. So that was from a Tomcat vulnerability. And you look at what the hackers did. They just put some gobbledygook in some of the HTTP headers. And, you know, had they had a web app firewall protecting them, that would have, you know, prevented that from happening. So that's the kind of thing I've been working on. I've been doing lots of helping people just deploy things out there in the cloud. So that's really what I've been doing. I've been learning the web application firewall. So it's everything at layer 7. It's kind of like SIP. You know, it's all happening at layer 7. Well, I'm helping people protect their HTTP at layer 7. And I've been learning a little bit about firewalls. I'm not a big firewall guy. So learning firewalling has been new for me as well. So that's primarily what I've been doing in the past year and a half or so. So kind of a departure from the telecom stuff.
So, it's funny. I remember, you know, spending a little bit of time with you while you were the community liaison, and just, you know, thinking about all the different Free Switch members and how much I idolized everyone. And, you know, there was always so many, like, fun stories that were going on and, like, interesting things. And so why don't you tell me about, you know, the craziest story or the greatest achievement or, you know, why you got originally involved.
Yeah. So let me go back. I want to go back to 2006 because a lot of people, like, I've been a telecom guy since 1994, but now back in 2004, 2005, I first heard of Asterisk, this open source PBX. I thought, oh, this is very interesting. But I wasn't there yet. And then I was just perusing the bookstore one day in Visalia, California, about in 2006, I believe. And I saw the Starfish book. I grabbed it, bought it immediately. I didn't know anything about, you know, whether Asterisk would even work or what. But I just grabbed it because I thought, you know, as soon as it has an O'Reilly book, then, you know, an open source project is, you know, they hit the big time, right? So it's a viable project. And started learning about that. But interestingly, I was reading through all of the credits at the beginning, and I saw this one credit. It says the unsung hero of Asterisk development was Anthony Minasali. I thought, oh, that's interesting. Well, right about that same time, Anthony was brewing up Asterisk 2.0 and Free Switch. And so that was kind of happening on the back burner. But like a lot of people, I got involved with Asterisk, and then I ran into a problem. And so I would go out to the Asterisk mailing list, see if I could find the problem, find a solution, and it just didn't happen. I think for me, it was something like CDRs. I was having a problem with call detail records. And so like a lot of people, I thought, oh, what am I going to do about this? And so I was poking around, and somebody on an Asterisk mailing list mentioned something called Free Switch. I didn't know anything about it. So I looked it up, and I'm like, wow, this is a very interesting project. It was still at 0.99 or something like that in the release, I was downloading. And for me, I wasn't quite ready for that yet, because what I was doing at the time, I was working for a collection agency. And what we needed to do was find a way to dial a lot of people and let them know that we needed them to pay their bill. And so what I did is I started creating the outbound IVRs, Hey, we're trying to reach, this is a message for Jersey Mike. You should pay your bill, something like that. So it was an outbound.
This is Jersey Mike. Press one now.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're a representative.
Yes. And again, you're talking 2006. And so everything I was doing was based on PRI and a T1. And what I had done is I'd talked my boss into buying me one of those old Zaptel or Tormenta 2. I think it was a Tormenta 2 4-port T1 card. And so I set this up where I had my one PRI line going in, and then I set up a back-to-back T1 with my NEC 2400 PBX that we had. And so I got that going. In fact, I was so proud of myself for figuring out all the knobs and switches that I had to turn that I actually documented it on it's the VoIPinfo.org, I believe, is the site. So I think it's still out there, actually. It was my very first contribution of anything significant to open source and to the community was, telling people, hey, here's how you get a Tormenta 2 to talk to an NEC 2400. I had all the dip switches and all that kind of stuff figured out. And so I was very proud of myself. And so that's where I kind of got started. And so I started doing just outbound dialing, mass dialing, and the interesting things that happen. And Ken's the expert on the interesting things that happen when you have to make thousands and thousands of phone calls a day. But Asterisk was kind of hard for me, and it wasn't working, but I wasn't ready for SIP and VoIP yet, so I kept my eye on the Free Switch project. But in, I think it was May of 2007, I heard of OpenZap. So the guys had finally gotten another endpoint for Free Switch, and that was my first introduction to how flexible the Free Switch platform is in terms of being modular. You just start plugging pieces in. And instead of having the big gumball, Asterisk like the big gumball, you just start sticking stuff on. But Free Switch really was, it's like the Lego bricks, right? You're building things and you're putting things together. And so when I heard of Mod OpenZap, I thought, well, this is interesting. And so what I did is I got it and started working with it. And I think I was the guy that Tony and Mike were like, okay, this is the guy who's going to, trip over all the bugs and all the things. And sure enough, I was getting Mod OpenZap, and I kept saying, okay, here's how I crashed it today. And most of it was me just, not setting it up right or having wrong things in the configuration. But that was really how I got involved with the project and trying to contribute back, because every time I got something working, I thought, oh, I wanted to contribute back and let everyone know so they don't have to go through what I went through. So that's why I started doing things like the wiki. I started putting stuff on
the wiki. Those are the old days, like copy and paste into the wiki.
Exactly. Exactly. And you still see some remnants of that where, I know we're going over in Confluence now, but you can still see that there are some remnants of things that were CNP from the IRC channel. But that's really where I got started. And so I built this outbound IVR, and what I was doing was I had all of these phone numbers that we had called with the professional IVRs, and I got results back like busies, no answers, or invalid phone numbers. I took all of those and I ran them through my kind of like, I called it MacGyver, MCIVR. So my MacGyver, I thought, no, I'll just run all the junk numbers through, because I didn't, I wasn't very confident in what I had built. So I thought, well, I'll take all these phone numbers that are that are probably not good anyway, and I'll run them through mine. And then what that let me do is get practice on building this outbound dialer and on numbers that were mostly bad. And so, but I found some, you know, that actually they went through. And so I got a hold of people. I would have left a message on an answering machine, or, you know, tried to get them to press a digit to transfer over to my, you know, magic bridge over to my phone system and talk to a human. So, but yeah, that's really where I got started. And as I got deeper and deeper into it, I went to my boss at the time where I was working. I said, hey, I'd like to give back. You know, they're helping us dial, make thousands and thousands of phone calls at, you know, pennies a minute instead of like 30 cents a minute, which is some of our professional items were at the time. And so my boss was like, okay, you could do that. And so I started doing the weekly call on Wednesday, still on Wednesdays. And I would, you know, lead the weekly call. And I do my best to, you know, document things on the wiki and stuff like that. So that's really how I got started. And that's when I first heard about KluCon as well. And because there was like one summer, you know, all the guys were just gone. I'm like, where's everybody at? You know, I've got questions, you know, and they're all at a secret meeting or something. It was a secret. I didn't realize, you know, at the time. They're all at all in Chicago. But the next year, Brian's like, what do we have to do to get you to KluCon? And so I said, well, I can scrounge up some money for a flight, but I could really use a place to stay. So Brian says, hey, if you get here, we'll get you a couch or something, someplace for you to sleep. And actually it turned out, this is one of the first crazy things. You know, Brian was so gracious. You know, when I took a red eye and I got there, and what happened was, I stumbled in, and I think it was Cherubrim. I stumbled into his hotel room, and I totally scared the crap out of him. But that was kind of my first interaction with the guys. But I went to KluCon, and the session already started. But I sat down at the only open seat I could find, and it turns out to my right was James Bodie, and to my left was Allison Smith. And so it was like, wow, there's all these, you know, cool people, and I didn't realize just who everybody was, you know, until later. But I'd heard of Allison Smith, but it was great to just sit down and I see all these people that I had, you know, talked to or, you know, seen or read about in books and magazines and things like that. So it was really fun to get to know everyone. But Brian says, hey, you need to come room with me. And so I think the first crazy thing I learned about Brian was he had these pajama pants, the famous, he had Dr. Pepper pajama pants. And it was hilarious because there's a, you know, story about how those, I think they got lost in a laundry accident. You can never find another set of them. But that was my first, you know, interaction with Brian as a, just as a guy, you know, just, you know, learning about people. So, but I had a lot of fun at the first KluCon, and that's where the guy said, hey, you want to come work for us? You know, if it works out that way, okay, maybe we can do that. So next thing you know, I'm working for Barracuda Networks, and I'm working with Tony, Mike, and Brian. New phone system. It was for me, it was crazy because I had never done anything like that. So I had a lot of fun doing that. So that's kind of the backstory about how I got involved, you know. And so now, in terms of craziness, I don't know. I have fun little stories. I don't have really crazy, crazy stories, but I do have some fun ones. Like trying to get, you know, Phil Zimmerman. You know, we had some great interactions with Phil Zimmerman. If you don't know, that's PGP. Yeah. So when we talk to Phil Zimmerman, we're talking about of PGP fame. And so, you know, getting him to come to KluCon, you know, he had we had fun getting him to come out, and, you know,
that was actually the last one you were at, right?
No, I had some KluCons later than that, but one of the ones, it was the one at the Trump Tower, 2010. So that was KluCon MMX, Brian was calling it. So that's where we were at, KluCon MMX, right? And so I think one of the craziest things I ever did was I drove for an hour and a half or 2 hours with Brian West from Milwaukee to Chicago in February. And that's where I learned that Brian, Brian talks to other drivers. He uses colorful metaphors in talking to other drivers. And I had a lot of fun there. It was crazy driving with Brian to you know, from Milwaukee to Chicago, and that's where we went. And that was the first time. I don't know if it was the first time, but it was we were gearing up KluCon, trying to get better at preparing the conference. And so we thought, well, if we could actually go and see the hotel and see the area and actually see things beforehand. And so we did. We drove down there. We just did a little day trip down to Chicago because we had been at Milwaukee for a developer meetup for Barracuda. And then we, you know, kind of took a little trip down. Brian's a crazy guy, and he's fun to be around. And hearing him, you know, talk to the other drivers with colorful language, it was great, because it was just totally different in terms of, you know, and Brian uses colorful language, descriptive language all the time. But hearing him talk to other drivers, well, for me, it was crazy. I'm like, because the first time he yelled at another driver, it scared me, because I'm like, what? But it was just Brian being Brian, you know, it's his personality. But he's very energetic, and that was one of the things that I really loved about working with Brian.
He can definitely add a lot to a conversation, that's for sure.
So it was, you know, a lot of interesting things going on. But yeah, I remember Phil. We had Phil Zimmerman, and you know. Again, when you meet people for the first time that you've read about or you heard about, you do get a little bit starstruck. And so I remember the first time I met Phil, and it was like, "Hey, Phil, you're going to come, you know, stay." We had a guy who had a spare bed in his hotel room, so we had Phil room with him. But I remember coming and say, "Hey, Phil," and I was showing him to his room, and then next thing you know, Phil's like, "Hey, could you give me some water?" I'm like, "Sir, yes, I will get you some water, absolutely. And can I get you this?" And it was just so funny, because it was, you know, I was like, "Okay, I will do anything. I will do your bidding, sir." You know, it was just you know, fun things. But Phil turned out just to be a really great guy. He's a funny guy. He's Uncle Phil, and he's telling his war stories about, you know, trying to get the code, you know, for PGP or for this, for all the encryption, you know, dealing with the government and all of that.
And the export too, right? Because...
Yeah, exactly. You know, and it went from, you know, he was worried the FBI was coming to arrest him. And then later on, it was when he was with Silent Circle, and it's like, somebody said, "Hey, Phil, the FBI is here." And he's like, "Uh-oh, I wonder who's getting arrested now." And they're like, no, they just want to know, you know, how much it's going to cost to buy their stuff, because they want to secure their communications. And so it was, you know, seeing how things have changed, you know, that was that. So, yeah, so we had, KluCon was awesome. There were always things going on at KluCon, always people to meet. There were always people coming and going, and we had some really good times. And one of the things, I think it was my first or second, I think it was my second KluCon, it was my first KluCon where I was actually with the team. But we had just got our first article published. I think it was in Linux Pro magazine. And I think there's still a reference to that article in the Confluence on the wiki. But published. And so it was the first time we had ever had FreeSwitch, like, in print in something that wasn't just a website. We had an actual published magazine, you know, and I had got it just a day or two before KluCon. So it was like, we were all passing it around. It's like, "Hey, we're for real. You know, we have, you know, we were mentioned in a magazine, you know, we have an actual article about us in Linux Pro." And so that was kind of nice.
Those are things you need to frame those things.
Yeah. I still have that somewhere, you know, and then that led to writing a book. And let me just tell you now, for the people, and, you know, Tony knows, you know, Giovanni knows, Darren Schreiber, they know, writing a book is one of the most unglamorous things you will ever do. It is hard work, it's thankless work, and it's really, really challenging. And I have newfound respect for people who produce a lot of books, especially the technical books with code that needs to be tested. Because, you know, when people don't test their code, right? You know, they put the code out there and you download it and it doesn't work. And it's like, what's going on? So writing the books for PACT Publishing, that was very interesting as well, because you're interacting with people and you have people, you want to test the code. You want people to, review what you've written. And it's a very interesting things. One of the interesting stories we had with PACT was they said, here's the cover of your new book. You know, it was the first Free Switch book. And the cover was, it was some very pretty agapanthus, you know, Lily of the Nile, I guess they're called. And we're like, what is this? You know,
can't we get an animal?
Yeah, where can't we do? I'm right. And Tony's like, what do these flowers have to do with real-time telecommunications? And PAC's like, well, this is, you know, this is kind of our claim to fame. We have these very fancy, you know, distinctive, you know, images on our covers. And I'm like, well, could we do something that isn't, you know, like for a feminine hygiene product or something like that? You know, we want something, you know, a little more, you know, to the point. And that's how they went back. And then that's where they got the cover of the first book was the, I think the Sydney Harbor Bridge was the image that we settled on. And that we're like, hey, that makes sense. You know, you bridge calls, you know, it's something's technical. It's in product of engineering. So that's what we ended up with was the Sydney Harbor Bridge was on the first Free Switch book. And so, yeah, that was one of those little things you don't hear about, you know, that originally it was going to be flowers. It was going to be the cover of the first Free Switch book. And thankfully we were able to avoid that. So that was one of those things that you,
flowers
you don't really hear about.
Flowers.
Yeah. The flowers, they were just a little too pretty. They were a little too delicate. It was, yeah, it just was not, it's not, you know,
the image. Tony,
yeah, you know, Tony, Mike, and Brian and these pretty little flowers. No, it just didn't make sense. So we were happy to happy to get that solved. So, but yeah, that's one of the fun things that we did. So writing a book, I'll tell you, that was challenging, but it was very nice to see the book get published. And one of the gratifying things was the PACT guys came back and said, hey, this book's like on our top 10 list, you know? So they went from like, yeah, we'll publish one of your books to like, hey, when are we going to do the next one? You know? And so that was kind of gratifying as well. And then we ended up doing, I think it was the cookbook was the next one that we did. So that, again, lots of interesting things going on behind the scenes.
I'll tell you, I personally purchased every one of those.
I did too. The next one, the 1.2 book, I think I got a credit for. I didn't do a whole lot of work on that. It's just some of the stuff that was from the 106 book was kind of grandfathered in. So my name's on the book, but I didn't do a lot of specific work on that. But then the one that Tony and Giovanni did, I bought that one the moment it came out. And I saw it, and then PACT was doing a $10 special. I'm like, oh, we can buy it right away. And I love that book. That was a great book, by the way, Tony and Giovanni. So thumbs up on that. But yeah, I had so many good memories with working with the guys, you know, going all the way back to when it was just a baby project. One of the things I appreciate about the Free Switch community is that not only was it where I learned about community, but After getting involved with Free Switch as an open source project, I started getting involved in other free software projects just because there are other things, you know, personal interest. And I saw their communities, and their communities are nice, but you know, I go back to the Free Switch community. It was, and it still is, it's very vibrant, worldwide, eclectic. Yet all of these crazy people have one thing in common, and that's they need, you know, they need Free Switch for something. You know, they're doing something with Free Switch, and it's so much fun talking to people all around the world. You know, people in India needing to build. There's a guy who's using it to talk to farmers in India, and I'm like, it's amazing what you use it for. Or talking to there's a blind kid in Algeria, and English is his second language, but it's so funny that, you know, when you get on the call and you hear he's talking to us in English, but his primary language is, it's like Arabic, but his screen reader is reading to him in French. And so it's like, you just, there's crazy things that you run into when you do Free Switch and you do the community, and the community is wonderful. So that's the thing I miss the most about, you know, having kind of gone away from working with Free Switch every day, is I don't get to see the community as much. So, but I do sneak in whatever I can, and sit on the call or sit in the channel or look at the email list. And one thing, now I got to tell you, some things never change. Some things never change. I've been monitoring the email list for years, and I think it was the last week or the week before, I saw a message, please don't report bugs to the mailing list. So I just had to laugh because it's like, yep, some things still don't change. There are still bugs being reported to the mailing list. And so, okay, good. You know, more things change, the more they stay the same. But yeah, I love seeing what's going on in the FreeSwitch community. And so it's, I try to stay kind of in touch. Since I don't do telephony from, you know, day to day, it's kind of like I have to sneak in, get some free time to see what's going on. So, but I try to stay up on what's going on. You know, when they added the video stuff, I was amazed at just how professional and how well done it is. So, again, hats off to the FreeSwitch guys for having this conference go from being just the audio conference where we had, half a dozen people, kind of show up and just chit chat about, FreeSwitch and putting stuff on the wiki. And now we're here doing video. So it's amazing. So, but yeah, ask me some questions because I think it would be easier if you ask me questions about specific things, I can kind of go back and back in history and we'll talk about some of the interesting things that happened. Oh, by the way, I wanted to show you my shirt just so you know. I don't know if you guys remember this one, but this is the from a few KluCons ago. I find your lack of a valid bug report disturbing. You know, that was one of Tony's designs. I remember doing KluCon. This is one of the things I did. And, Tony and Brian really appreciate this. When the project is small, some people do everything. And, I called in, I was talking to the guys yesterday, and it's a reminder that in some respects, you still do everything, but you now have people dedicated for various things. But when I first started working for Barracuda, one of the stipulations for me working for Barracuda was that if Tony Mack and Brian went to work on the CudaTel product, then we still need bodies to work with FreeSwitch and with the community. And so, they let us hire a couple guys, and I was one of the guys that got hired. And so a lot of my work was with FreeSwitch and with the community. And so, one of my jobs was to hang out in IRC and do my best to help people stay on the mailing list and answer questions. And so we tried to develop a reputation for helping people as quickly as we could. And to, we wanted to make sure that people, when they came to FreeSwitch, especially if they were coming either from Asterisk or just coming from one of those big iron or, a commercial product, we wanted people to realize FreeSwitch is for real. It's a real product, and it may be free, it may be open source, but it is really, really good at what it does. But because it's so powerful, it also is, there's some level of barrier to entry can be.
When you go to a lot of these events, which, outside of, KluCon is always my favorite, but, when you go to the ones that are outside, I mean, people just come to you in droves and they go, well, I really want to start using FreeSwitch. I know I shouldn't be using this, but how can I start doing it? And I think that's one of the more challenging things is it's onboarding and education of new members and getting them to, start using FreeSwitch and getting it to work for their specific customized needs. It becomes very challenging.
Yeah.
Especially when they have a history and they have a long, upstanding, relationship with other call switching software, which doesn't particularly work the way they want to.
No, yeah, absolutely. And so when people join, and I remember seeing the IRC when I first started joining, IRC had I think 50 or 60 people in the IRC channel. And we just kept growing and growing. And then it was, I remember we broke 100. And it was like, yeah, we got 100 people here. And then it was 150, then 200. And I think we were north of 250, 300. But we had a lot of people in the IRC channel. And I'm one of those crazy guys who actually likes to write documentation. And I like to document things. And when I figure something out, I like to make sure that it gets codified somewhere. And it's written down. And so I actually liked being in the IRC channel, talking to people, and I liked helping them solve their problems. I love grepping through logs. I don't know why, I just do. I guess I just like trying to dig for the treasure, you know, trying to find the what's the log line that's going to, you know, crack the nut on this symptom that we're trying to resolve. And so I love doing that. And so I love documentation. And so that's why, especially on the old wiki, you know, when you look at how many commits I did, especially on the old wiki, I think it was thousands of you know, wiki posts, you know, editing the original wiki, and just, but I love doing it. And so getting paid to sit in the IRC channel and talk to people and to talk about FreeSwitch and to try different, you know, configurations or try to solve certain problems or make FreeSwitch do things, you know, answer questions on the mailing list. You know, those aspects of my job were just wonderful. I loved doing that. So that was one of the things I really enjoyed. You know, learning how to run KluCon, being the person who sends out all the marketing emails. And, you know, Brian had to teach me how to use Adobe Illustrator and Photoshop, because I didn't know how to put these, you know, graphics together. I didn't know anything about graphics and, you know, calling hotels and, you know, tracking down people and filling out documentation so that people from overseas could come over and, you know, actually get into the country, you know? So it's, you know, lots of things like that, that are, yeah, I learned a lot. Didn't always enjoy everything in those aspects. I was talking to Sharon, you know, prepping for KluCon is a lot of work, and it's, you pull your hair out, as you can tell, you know, I pulled my hair out. But building up the KluCon, it's like, oh, I hate this. And then,
well, what did you find? What was the most, back in the day, what was the most frustrating part?
The most frustrating part for me, I think, was just not knowing how to do certain things. You know, and there's some things that you just had to figure out how to do. And I relied on Brian as much as I could. And first of all, kudos to Tony, Mike, and Brian for, you know, being patient with me learning. And Brian spent a lot of time just being a mentor to me. But learning how to do things that I didn't know how to do or that were not in my area of expertise. Running a conference, there's so many things you do behind the scenes. You have to interact with all of your sponsors, and you have to figure out, you know, what's their sponsorship level going to be, and what's going to be involved, and how are we going to, you know, get the website updated to show who's the sponsors, and then what are the sponsors going to do, and, you know, and like Flow Route used to do like some of the bags, like the goodie bags, you know, or the tote bags. And so we had to figure out what their logo was going to be, what their, you know, artwork was going to be. And then you had to figure out, you know, who the speakers are, and then trying to figure out, you know, who's going to speak when, and, you know, who's coming in, who's flying in and out. It's just logistics and things like that. And then just not knowing, you know, I didn't know how to decide what size t-shirts to order. You know, it's like there's all of these things that are they're non-technical in nature, but they're absolutely necessary for a conference to go off without a hitch. And not knowing how to do those things, and I can't tell you how many landmines I stepped on, you know, how many times I messed something up. You know, I ordered a banner I wasn't supposed to order, or I used the wrong graphic, or, you know, I thought I asked the question right to get approval, and I either asked it wrong, or I didn't, you know, I did something, you know, you make mistakes, right? And yeah, I guess the most frustrating thing was screwing things up. You know, then Brian would be all, hey, don't worry, you know, we all screw up, and don't, just learn from it, you know. You know, you screw up once, that's one thing, but mistake again, then, you know, they were really going to be mad. So it's like, you know, and sometimes I did. So it's just a learning curve. But Beyond that, though, I mean, that it's the things that you don't know how to do that you're learning how to do. That was the most frustrating part. But beyond that, I really enjoyed everything, just being with people. And on the Barracuda side, I'd never been involved in developing a product before. So products, engineering, software engineering, I'd never really gotten that deep down in doing things. And so I learned a lot there too. And again, developing software, learning how to use Git, you know, that was probably the most frustrating. And when Git would give me a crazy error, I didn't know how to figure it out. I'm like, William, you know, come help me with this, you know, figure that out. So things like that, you know, but for me, what I found out was I found out what I was good at and what I was not good at, you know, and there was a lot of things I wasn't good at, and a few things that I was good at. Interacting with people, interacting with the community, interacting with on the commercial side of things, interacting with our customers. That was what I was really, really enjoyed. And I guess I was good at talking to people, you know, and I had years, you know, decades of experience with PBXs and telephones and things like that. So it was easy for me to talk to people about, hey, what are your phone system needs, or what problems are we trying to solve? What is your business trying to do? And so I really enjoyed that, and I was good at that. So I became a sales engineer toward the end of my tenure on the Cuditel team, and that was the right seat on the bus for me. We found out, so I love doing that. So, but all of the things that I learned along the way, you know, all of the challenges and all of that really helped. Yeah, find out, you know, who's, you know, it's just and you had to accept that there were sometimes that there's nothing you could do to please everyone. So just, yeah, do your best, and you know.
So what do you miss the most?
What I miss the most, is I miss the people. I miss being around all of these cool people. I miss, you know what? Tony is good at a lot of things. And I think what I miss the most are his little quips. He's got these little quips. He just out of nowhere will just say something that is ridiculously hilarious. To nerds, right? To nerds and geeks, you know. But he'll like one time William was talking, and his voice just went into the strange kind of a stuttery sound that was just right out of Star Wars, and without missing a beat, Tony's all, stay on target, just out of nowhere. And it was perfect. It was just the perfect joke at the perfect time. And he does that all of the time. And so that's one of the things I miss. I miss his analogies too. He is the king of analogies. It just, he'll come up with, oh, it's kind of like this. And he'll just have a perfect analogy that actually makes everything make sense and puts things in perspective. And so yeah, I miss the people. I miss working with Brian. Brian and I, there was a point there, like when we were spinning up, both in FreeSwitch and in Cuditel, where we were just dealing with bugs, dealing with issues, you know, things were happening. We had to figure out what's going on. And so Brian and I spent a lot of time, you know, sifting through logs and reproducing symptoms, trying to figure it out. And so I do miss those days. And I don't miss the frustrating problems, but I do miss, you know, working with Brian, trying to figure out what's going on and how do we solve this problem, or how are we going to make FreeSwitch do this, or how are we going to make the product do this and present it to the user in a way that they're not going to mess it up, and, you know, things like that. So I miss that. I miss the community. You know, I really enjoy interacting with people, because every day it seemed like somebody would come into the IRC channel or to the mailing list and say, hey, I'm trying to make FreeSwitch do this. And you're like, I never thought of using FreeSwitch to do that. Or, oh, I've never had to solve that problem before, you know? And so those are the things that I miss the most about, you know, not being in the, you know, directly involved anymore. So if I could change one thing, that would be, I would make my day job still have to, you know, be involved in the community all the time. That would be the one thing. If I could have any wish, that's what it would be.
Well, thank you, Michael. Do we have any comments from the community or questions?
Well, I want to say something. I think what he's trying to say he misses the most is how Anthony does. He's the king of analogies. Remember that, Collins?
Yeah, that is absolutely correct. Yeah, so I'm sorry if my audio is breaking up. Make you think AT&T U-verse for that. But yes.
Yeah, they've had some problems with video distribution, right? More recently?
Yeah, they sure have. So, but yes. So, but first of all, thank you very much for having me on. When Sharon reached out and said, hey, we'd like to have you come on, I was like, well, absolutely. I would love to come and talk about my experiences. You know, it's hard to believe how long it's been, you know, but I think my first interactions with Mike and Brian were back in, I think it was 2006. I mean, so that's a long time. I remember when I first learned about the Free Switch Project, and I think I sent Mike an email and said, hey, or I think I downloaded it and I think I had to plug in my email or something. I think Mike reached out to me or I reached out to Mike, but at some point it was small enough that, you know, you could talk to most of the people who downloaded Free Switch. And I said, hey, yes, I'm not very technical. I don't know a lot about VoIP and SIP. I said, but I can do lots of documentation. And Mike's like, great. You know, we want documentation on our project. And so, and that was even before OpenZAP. But I remember I knew Free Switch, you know, even before I was using Free Switch, I knew that Free Switch was going to be what I needed, even before it was able to use the PRI cards that I needed from my project at the time. So what I did was I got on the wiki and I downloaded it as a PDF and I printed out certain sections of it. And I remember I was living in apartments over in North Fresno, and my kids were really young at the time, and so every now and then I just needed to get away. So I would take my printouts and I'd go on my exercise bike, you know, over in the gym, and I would just be reading over all of the dial plan stuff, you know, all the dial plan applications. And I just remember thinking, man, I wish I could use this, or I can't wait until either I learn how to use SIP or, you know, we get some, you know, TDM, you know, connectivity here in Free Switch. And so I remember that I knew Free Switch was, you know, what I was going to use. I could just tell. I don't know how, you know, sometimes you look at stuff and you're like, you know, I understand how they're building it. I'm like, I looked at the code and I'm like, I don't really understand a lot of the code, but I could tell by the way it was being designed and the way things were being built and put together that this was definitely the way you should build this kind of a project. It was modular and you had the core. Nobody touches the core, right? Tony can go in there, you know, don't mess with the core. He's got all these APIs so that you can interact with the core. So if you can't interact with the core with an API, then Tony will find a way to make the API work for you. But I think one of the stamps of validation, Brian will remember this. I remember when Skype was really big and the Silk codec I think it was first released, and Brian got his hands on some Silk code, and there's some C code, and he took that code and he got it compiled and he made a mod Silk or something like that, and he gave me, he said, hey Collins, download this. And I knew that this was like a stamp of validation on Free Switch being a really well written project for real time communications, is when Brian says, here, download this code, compile it, and then load it on your Free Switch. And I remember I downloaded Mod Silk or whatever we called it, and I compiled it, and then I loaded it, and we made calls over the Silk codec without ever having to restart Free Switch. It was amazing. I think I had to do a reload Mod XML or something like that, and that was the extent of having to, you know, get a brand new codec working on Free Switch. And so when you could do stuff like that, you know that the project is and the product is really well written. So that was one of my favorite experiences, because it's like, how do you do that? How do you just grab code off the internet and then tweak it a little bit, and then you build a codec module, and then you load it onto a running system that and without disrupting and making calls over that new codec. I mean, it's just it's amazing that the project can do that, but it can. So it's things like that. Those are the kinds of memories I have, and I have lots of memories like that. And so, yes, I'm very, very happy for all the time I got to spend with the free source project.
There's also one thing about that you'll remember, that we had the it was when Silk was released in the spec. We had to write a Perl script to extract the code. So we had the spec was released, and we had the code in the tree and the codec building within 30 minutes of the release of the spec.
Yes, that's right. I remember it. Not only did it happened in record time. And it's like, I have so many of those kinds of fond memories of really cool things happening. And so if you're new to the Free Switch project, stick with it. It's really cool. The people are cool. The community is fantastic, and the project is wonderful. And I just last night, actually, I went and I downloaded the latest and greatest, and then I went, you know, cruising around in Stash and looking at the code, and I'm like, I've been here before, you know, but then there's a lot more stuff there. I'm like, I see the Virto stuff is in there, and I can see how much it's grown since I've been there last, and I'm like, this is fantastic. But it's still the same project in terms of, you know, the people, the problems it's solving. It's getting better at solving problems, and it's being able to solve more problems. So, two thumbs up. Love Free Switch. Love the community. And so, if there's anything I could do to ever, you know, be, you know, have my day job be working with Free Switch again, I wouldn't mind that at all. It's wonderful. So again, thank you so much for having me. If you guys have any questions, you know, feel free to chat. Or you see, I still have my freeswitch.org email. It still works. I still check it. So.
Well, thank you, Michael, for coming in. You're truly an iconic member of the community. That's true.
Thank you.
So we appreciate you coming in today.
Thank you so much.
Ken, back to you.
All right. Thank you very much, guys. So, Mr. Collins, great to see you again. Jersey Mike, thanks for all the help today. And big shout out to Fred. Fred, thanks for answering the question on Community Corner today. We'll see you guys back here next week. And I believe we have Mr. Randy Resnick will be joining us. So you guys don't want to miss that. That's always a fun time when Randy pops around. We'll see you guys next week. Have a good weekend.
You've been watching KluCon Weekly. Tune in every Wednesday at 12 p.m. Central. Keep up with the latest happenings by subscribing to our YouTube channel, follow us on Facebook and Twitter, or visit us at freeswitch.com.